हरिओम। लेट अस बिगिन द सेशन विथ थ्री ओंकारास। सिट स्ट्रेट इन योर चेयर्स, टेक अ डीप ब्रेथ। Welcome to the third day of the 21st INCOFERA, International Conference on Frontiers of Yoga Research and Its Applications. Welcome to the Symposia 4. The main theme is mental health. Let me first invite all the speakers onto the dais. First, I would like to invite our chairperson onto the dais, Dr. B.N. Gangadhar, Professor of Psychiatry, NIMHANS, Bengaluru. Welcome, sir. Let me also invite the speakers of the session, Dr. Rajesh Sagar, Associate Professor of Psychiatry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Let me invite Dr. Savita Eranti onto the dais. Let me also invite Dr. Shivarama Varamballi, Associate Professor of Department of Psychiatry, NIMHANS, onto the dais. Before I hand over the session to our chairperson, let me give you a brief introduction of Dr. B.N. Gangadhar. He is the Professor of Psychiatry and Dean of Behavioral Sciences in NIMHANS, and he is the Honorable Dean of Life Sciences, S. Vyasa Yoga University. He has published over 240 scientific articles in peer-reviewed national and international journals. His research areas include ECT, RTMS and yoga, schizophrenia and community psychiatry. He heads an advanced center for yoga therapy at NIMHANS, and he has coordinated the development and design of a patented indigenous ECT machine. He has received the prestigious Sir C.V. Raman Award in 1999 and the B.C. Roy Award in 2010 by the Karnataka government. He is also the fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences. He has guided 4 PhDs and nearly 20 MD dissertations. Dr. Gangadhar is the associate editor of the Psychiatria Scandinavica and a co-editor for the Asian Journal of Psychiatry. Welcome, sir. I hand over the session to you.
Good afternoon. Before we start, can I request all the students who are sitting there on the we probably have to wait until some moving population becomes quieter. Can I request all the students to either come inside and be seated or be outside this podium in the hall? Welcome to this session on mental health. Yoga and mental health are inseparable. The very first aphorism of Patanjali refers to yoga chitta vritti nirodha. So which means yoga has an important role to play with our mind, and very rightly the organizers have dedicated a separate session for mental health and its applications in yoga. I'm afraid that the organizers have to make some special efforts to quieten the whole place. Maybe otherwise we should it's extremely noisy. Yeah, and it's also important, being noisy is helpful to keep our postprandial sleep off, hoping at least it has that benefit to offer. Okay, let me introduce the first speaker, Dr. Savita Sri Eranti. Dr. Savita is from Nimhans, where she passed out her MD in psychiatry with a gold medal. She moved on to be a consultant in UK. She's had extensive research experience, currently working with community mental health team. She has published several scientific articles in some of the very prestigious journals in psychiatry. Journals which can be ranked number one or two carry her articles. And I request Dr. Savita Sri Eranti to speak to us about an overview of common mental disorders. In the morning session, we heard an overview of severe or serious mental disorders, and in this session we are going to have three papers, three presentations, one by Dr. Savita Sri Eranti on an overview of common mental disorders, followed by a review on depression and diabetes. Both are very linked, and towards the end we are going to have a talk on how yoga can be used in these conditions, mental disorders, and how the evidence has been pulled out. Let me introduce the first speaker and request Dr. Savita Sri Eranti to address all of us. Madam.
Today, I'll be giving an overview of common mental health disorders. I'm sure all of you have heard of these terms, and all of us have anxiety or depressive symptoms at one point or the other. I'm going to just talk about when they become disorders and how we understand them in terms of the various models available, and based on our understanding, how we can help these conditions, and what is the potential for yoga in this field. Common mental disorders are quite a significant problem. As you can see, WHO has ranked it as one of the highest disabling conditions present, and about 350 million people worldwide suffer from depression alone. About 800,000 people a year commit suicide. And in younger population, which is 15 to 29 year old, WHO ranks suicide as the second leading cause of death. So there is some work to be done in this area. And about a third of the disability in the low and medium income countries, 25 to 33%, is related to these common mental disorders. at least 5% of the population is shown to suffer from common mental disorder in a cross-sectional survey in 17 countries by WHO. It's much higher in women, especially the manifestation of depression, which we will look at in a different slide later. So what are these common mental disorders? We've already heard of depression and anxiety disorders, and I will talk about this in a bit more detail. But there are others, like obsessive-compulsive disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, adjustment disorders, and somatic and conversion disorders, to name a majority of the common mental disorders. As I'm not going to be covering adjustment disorders later, I will just tell a few words about it. Basically, as the name suggests, adjustment disorder is an adjustment problem in terms of emotional health after a significant stressful event. For example, it can be loss of a loved one, loss of a job, loss of a house, or something significant to the person. And the adjustment disorders can last between 6 months to 2 years and causes disability in a person's life in terms of their functioning. Essentially, a lot of these neurotic or common mental disorders, or otherwise sometimes referred to as minor psychiatric disorders, is conceptualized as an imbalance between coping and stress. All of us have stress, either major stress, like I mentioned, or minor stress, like day-to-day commuting, financial stress, driving on roads. Everything causes stress. It's how we cope with it will determine how we function in day-to-day life. A lot of these disorders can be an imbalance between these two. Now I'm going to talk to you a little bit about depression. Depression can be a severe psychiatric disorder. As Dr. Pandurangi was mentioning this morning, it can be a cause of suicide. This depression can be that severe. But on the other hand, it can be minor or mild and can be a common mental disorder. For us to determine that it's a major depressive episode, they are likely to have a lot of the symptoms, including low mood, physical symptoms as well as cognitive symptoms, and at least the low mood should be pervasive, which means to say it is present all hours of the day and night and persistent for at least 2 weeks for us to say it's a major depressive disorder. And once a person has a major depressive disorder, it can be just one episode, or as Dr. Pandurangi was mentioning, it can be a part of a bipolar disorder which is manic episode, the reverse of depression, alternating with depressive disorder. So I'm not going to talk about bipolar disorder, which is a severe psychiatric disorder, whereas depression in the context of mild to moderate depressive episode or a chronic dysthymia is what we are thinking about in a common mental disorder. Chronic dysthymia is a depression which persists for years, and it's low grade. Sometimes people can have low mood for several hours a day or several hours a week, but certainly it's causing dysfunction in terms of their personal, social, and work life. Now, the symptoms of depression, as I suggested, can be definitely low mood. Biological symptoms, such as affecting one's sleep and appetite. Diurnal variation of mood, what we mean by it is either the depression is worse in the mornings consistently or worse in the evenings when people are worrying. Or you can have cognitive symptoms, which are negative thoughts, excessive worrying, hopelessness, helplessness, death wishes, suicidal thoughts, and so on. There can be other somatic symptoms. All of us have experienced headaches when we are tense or upset about something. Similarly, in depressive disorders, you can have a lot of physical symptoms. It's a very common problem, depression, but it goes unrecognized, and sometimes it may take years before it's identified and treated. And moreover, there may be issues in people seeking help because they don't think it's a disorder. They think, oh, I'm not coping properly, there's something wrong with my life, but I don't need help. NICE is National Institute of Clinical Excellence in the UK, which is an organization and a body which looks at all the research evidence and gives clinical recommendations. They've recommended two very simple questions for you to start identifying depression in general medical practice or general practice in holistic care. For example, just asking, during the last month, have you ever felt depressed? Or are there times when you felt that you could not enjoy the activities that you used to before, which could be watching a TV serial in the evenings, or going to the cinema, or going out to eat with friends? And if it is positive, then you do further screening for depression and assessment. The risk of depression is much higher in women, as you can see in this graph. And from the mid-20s onwards, the incidence and prevalence of depression increases in women. There are variations in how depression presents, especially in the Indian context. Women can present with aches and pains all over the body, which is otherwise termed as a somatization disorder. And many a times, this is a manifestation of underlying depression, where one of the theories is that physical symptoms are more recognizable as a disease rather than when one says, I'm feeling low in mood. It's one of the theories. Alcohol use or alcohol problems could be manifestation of depression in males. So it's not that there's no depression in men. Certainly they do present, but sometimes they present with other symptoms such as alcohol dependence. Sometimes anxiety problems such as social anxiety could be a reason why somebody is presenting with alcohol problems. So treating the underlying depression and anxiety will be important in these people. One of the other theories is depression is where one internalizes anger. Instead of being angry with the world, they start blaming themselves and become depressed. Now, what about anxiety disorders? All of us have anxiety, maybe speaking in front of an audience or any other task. All of us can have some anxiety symptoms. Just about having a little bit of anxiety is actually functional. One can perform better. But at times, anxiety can become a disorder when it becomes disabling and affects a person's functioning and life. There are lots of anxiety disorders. One of the main categories is a generalized anxiety disorder, and there are others which I'll cover in the next slide, but there's also social and performance anxiety, which are specific to social situations or performance-related tasks like giving a talk, etc. Generalized anxiety disorder is when they cannot really give a reason as to why they're anxious. There's a lot of free-floating anxiety, lot of worrying, arousal symptoms in the form of palpitations, like the heart beating fast or dizziness, sweating, feeling lightheaded, having epigastric discomfort, feeling nauseous, and these can be present consistently over a period of time, which can affect their functioning, including, for example, going out. This is panic disorder. This is another anxiety disorder. The main problem is a recurrent, unexpected, episodic anxiety or panic attacks where they can have all the symptoms that I described just now, but lasting few seconds to minutes at a time, and then it's gone. There is a worry associated that the disorder may come again and the behavior starts changing. They may not want to be in situations where they cannot escape if they have a panic disorder. There's a fear that they may lose control. There's a fear that they might die. This is agoraphobia, which is another form of anxiety of spaces from which people cannot escape from. It could be lifts. It could be busy shopping malls, crowded areas, and they're worried. They might get anxious or a panic attack, and they may not be able to leave the place, and avoidance behaviors start. Post-traumatic stress disorder is another common mental disorder. It occurs after a major disastrous event, such as, for example, tsunami, floods, earthquakes, or even a rape, which is personal to the individual. And after a major stress, the symptoms reflect the trauma in the form of nightmares or repeated flashbacks and arousal and anxiety symptoms, which I've already mentioned, like palpitations, dizziness, and so on. The obsessive compulsive disorders, very briefly, are associated. It's a completely different manifestation, but comes under common mental disorders, where people have repetitive, intrusive thoughts which come into their mind, which are involuntary, but they are their own thoughts. For example, a person may be completely obsessed about germs, being infected with germs, and they might be repeatedly cleaning their hands, or they may have repeated blasphemous thoughts about religion or God, and they're not able to get rid of it, and they do compulsive acts like washing their hands repeatedly in order to relieve the anxiety. They know it's an irrational fear, but they cannot control it. A lot of these disorders have a close relationship between the body, mind, and the spiritual self. And the symptoms as well are in these various areas. And it's important for us to make sure that we tackle all the areas in order to help the individuals. And the important thing to remember is all these common mental disorder symptoms can also occur in the general population, and it may be better to prevent further development into a disorder by intervening early. One of the other biological theories talking about understanding these symptoms include neurotransmitter systems or chemicals in the brain. Various chemicals in the brain are associated with various emotions, but there is a considerable overlap, as you can see here. For example, motivation and reward systems can be associated with dopamine, impulsivity with serotonin, and then you have the norepinephrine system, and all these chemicals can be quite low in depression, and some of the antidepressants which are used is actually to increase these neurochemical transmitters. But this morning we heard in one of the plenary sessions talks that yoga actually increases some of these neurotransmitters. In terms of treatment, commonly we're talking about pharmacological treatment and non-pharmacological treatment. Although in severe mental disorders, pharmacological treatment plays a significant role, in common mental disorders, it's the non-pharmacological treatments which will be the mainstay. And I will illustrate a few studies to show in a different area how non-pharmacological treatments are better or equal to pharmacological treatments, which are actually antidepressant medication like fluoxetine, mirtazapine, reboxetine, or even benzodiazepines, which can be addictive. A lot of these medications have side effects, and therefore people are not keen to take this medication, especially in the West. Some of the non-pharmacological treatments, the most well-researched is cognitive behavior therapy. Essentially, it has cognitive elements which looks at the relationship between thoughts, feeling, and behavior, and the behavioral aspects looking at doing things and doing structured activities. For example, when somebody is depressed, they're not doing much with their day, and they're sitting at home, unmotivated, and feeling hopeless. So based on these principles, there are several studies which have looked at it. An initial study showed that in the short term, cognitive behavior therapy was as good as antidepressant medication. But when they looked at how these effects were sustained, it was quite clear that the prevention of relapse was better with non-pharmacological treatment rather than with medication. Here's an example of a study in the short term at 8 weeks and a follow-up at 16 weeks. Both pharmacological CBT and antidepressant medication are compared here. In the longer term, this particular study showed that both were as effective even when used alone and pharmacological treatment was not required. But further to that, if you look at other studies which have been published, it's clearly the non-pharmacological treatment had a better response rate which was sustained at follow-up. meta-analysis are studies where they put together data from all the individual studies, reanalyze it so that there is a large sample size and one can see what the results are with a larger sample size, which is much more meaningful. Clearly, any treatment arm where there was a cognitive therapy that was involved, there was a better response rate and 61% less relapse in that group. I'm not going to talk about that example study here. It's not only in depression, similar results from panic disorder. The first two green bars are variants of CPT, whereas all the others, which are yellow, orange, and red bars, are actually medication. You can see the response rate for non-pharmacological treatment is certainly better and well-sustained. Similarly, for social phobia, you have similar results as well. In fact, as I mentioned, in the West, they don't want to take the pills. They're looking for other options. One of the new things that we are looking at the moment is mind-body treatments. One of the concepts of meditation is now incorporated into Western treatments, and they call it mindfulness, which is nothing but being in the present in an open, non-judgmental and accepting manner. Several theories of why this works in therapy is having the right mindfulness, not having an over-engagement resulting in worrying, or under-engagement which characterizes avoidance of some of the anxiety disorders, and therefore the right level of attention to the present moment is suggested as beneficial, and mindfulness is a very popular treatment in the West at the moment. Similarly, you can see NHS is the National Health Service in the UK. It has a guide to yoga, which gives links to resources available, and now there are yoga options being developed in various general practice surgeries, as well as various well-being centers, and all the gyms have yoga classes, so it's not only looked at as a therapeutic aspect, but as well it's for well-being and prevention as well. So I'm not going to discuss the studies of yoga in depression or anxiety, which will be later. One of the co-presenters perhaps will cover that. All I am going to say is there is a huge scope, and there's a huge population out there who can be helped with yoga for treatment of depression, anxiety, and perhaps other common mental health disorders. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Savita. Maybe you can sit down. Just for the information of all the audience here, at the end of the three talks, you will be free to ask questions, because there could be overlapping subjects: depression, common mental disorders, depression and diabetes, and then treatment of severe and common mental disorders using yoga. So I'll go to the next session. Next presenter, let me introduce Dr. Rajesh Sagar. Dr. Rajesh Sagar, again an alumnus from NIMHANS, Bangalore. After passing out the MD in psychiatry at NIMHANS, he went on to teach at the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, where he now works as a professor of psychiatry. Dr. Rajesh Sagar has been a member of several important professional bodies. He is the secretary for the Mental Health Authority of India at the capital. He is also the joint advisor of mental health. He is an advisor, consultant in many professional bodies, which include the World Health Organization, Indian Council of Medical Research. He is also into the various advisory committees of many of the AYUSH departments like the homeopathy, yoga, and so on and so forth. To his credit, he has had several publications. Currently, he is into a large-scale, multi-center, international study looking at depression and diabetes. Having said this much about Dr. Rajesh Sagar, I request him to make his presentation. Dr. Sagar.
Namaskara to you, all of you, and good afternoon. And is one
Modi. Namaskara from Hyderabad, Delhi.
And thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here in Bangalore. Dr. Anand is also here, and wonderful campus. In fact, I am here for the first time. Though as a resident, I used to come to Sakalwara for my posting, but I never visited this place. And at the outset, I think I must thank Professor Gangadhar, who happens to be a teacher and guru, and to invite me for this important lecture here, and to visit this place. I think wonderful of you, and I'm very thankful to that. Now, what I will do, because as has been introduced, that my talk will be basically into this study what we are doing on depression and diabetes. This is one of the important study, like in US, this, the grant has been given by US, and India there are 4 centers, and US there are 2 centers, which, so I will be talking about that, and before that I will talk in general about diabetes and depression. Now I understand that there is a parallel session going on for diabetes also, but here it's a combination of two, like, you know, what happens when the depression occurs in diabetes and the vice versa. So perhaps that will be the focus of my talk. And what I will do, I will try to focus into this particular area only, and maybe skip off certain things. Okay, I think we all know about depression, that how it affects our body, mind, and, you know, it's so devastating. And we all know about this. I think we had a wonderful lecture by previous speaker. So we know about that, how distressing the depression is. The important thing is that the type 2 diabetes is much at higher risk, you know, higher rate for developing symptoms of depression. Those who have diabetes, they have much higher rate of developing a depression than in general population. Like if you see, let's say 100 people with diabetes and 100 people with without diabetes, and those with diabetes, there are chances are almost double to have a depression. So you can understand, and this is the evidence all over the world, including India. And the important thing is that it has to, and we need to treat both these conditions individually. It doesn't mean that, you know, only have to treat one condition. First we have to identify the other condition, also we have to treat it. And and also the reasons are many. In fact, there are several reasons. One of the important reason is that perhaps because a person who has a diabetes, they have additional stress is there for management of, you know, for diabetes, which may predispose them for depression. And also there are diabetes metabolic effect, which may affect the brain, for which one may have a depression. And alternatively, there is also a possibility that people with depression may also develop diabetes, is vice versa, you know. And those who have a depression, like, you know, in a clinical practice, what we see in our day-to-day OPD, like the place where I am working, is a general hospital setting. So we get lot of cases of course, they come for depression, but at the same time, they also have diabetes, hypertension, and so on. And the important thing to remember is that when a person has more than one condition, obviously it is more distressing, more dysfunctioning, and so on. And we need to understand, in addition to increase the risk for depression, diabetes makes symptoms of depression worse. So what it means is, not only there is the occurrence of depression in diabetes, but also the severity is also much more of either of these conditions. It's not only the occurrence, but also the severity is much more. And the stress contribute to the development of depression. According to NICE, I think we just heard about the guideline, though it is being said that it, risk is about 3 times in that particular guidelines as per the United Kingdom. and it can have a serious impact on overall well-being, you know, or what we call as a psychological well-being, a physical well-being, and also ability to motivate to self-management their condition, and also the family also, because not only the individual, but the whole family is also affected. That is, we need to understand that. We are not just focusing on individual. Let's say, for example, a person has to go to hospital, has to go for investigation, so a lot of cost is also involved. So not only the individual, but also family is affected. And we all know depression is one of the commonest condition in people who have one of the important common mental disorder in people who have diabetes. And people with diabetes suffering for depression are at greater risk for suffering from episode of diabetes burnout. What it means is, because they are so much involved with their self-care, self-management, it may lead to the burnout, and which may itself have the adverse effect on the physical health, and also, you know, as a potential threat for the long-term complications. Now, and this is one of the important study, you know, which the crux is that basically the depression, when it occurs in the people with diabetes, it also contributes to poor adherence to the medication. Now, let me tell you, for these reasons, because in our institute, if you see our diabetes clinic, and you know, it's very nearby, it is just about 10 meters away, you know. So some of the consultant with diabetes, they take the patient to my clinic and say that this person, in spite of all the efforts, he is not improving, the diabetes status is not improved, please do something, you know. But they have, so ultimately, and also because in diabetes we know that a person has to take up regular medication, not only medication, they have to do regular exercise, they have to adhere to certain diet regime and so on. So what happens, the person who has depression, in these people with diabetes, they have a problem with the adherence, like, you know, taking these medicines or compliance, the problem of dietary regime, physical inactivity, because all the diabetes, they always say that you should do physical activity. A person who has depression, there is inactivity, they do not do all this because of many reasons. And also poor glycemic control. Glycemic control, like if a person with a diabetes, what we do, HbA1c, that's one level which is being done. So that, you know, so it is commonly seen people with depression also has higher level of glycemic level. And reduced quality of life, and disability, and increased healthcare expenditure, and so on. So just imagine, a person with diabetes who have a depression can have so many complications and so many adverse consequences are there. And diabetes, we all know, is a chronic lifelong condition, and which of course has a risk for other illnesses and also of the death also. And it is also important to understand, because depression is, you know, as per the disability and burden, it's number two, and it's, in 2030 it is said to be, you know, it is the leading cause of burden or disability. Now, diabetes, we all know, it is basically a condition where there is hyperglycemia, increased blood sugar level, you know. And it also affects the carbohydrate, protein, and fat metabolism, you know, and there is a insufficient development of the insulin. So basically, that's a basic thing about diabetes. I will skip this. And depression, already we have talked about. And depression, just want to say one thing, because it has to be what we call as it has to be persistent, more than 2 weeks. And it has to be pervasive, that it has to occur in different situations. And also, like when a layperson says, I am depressed, does not mean that he has depression, you know. So it does not mean that when a person says, I am depressed, so one has to look at all the clinical symptoms of depression. That is not enough, but one has to look at the dysfunction also. So that is how the diagnosis of depression is made. Now, these are the risk factors for depression in diabetes. Like if a person who has a diabetes, now this is based on important study, then and these are the risk factors. Like these are the risk factors, like if person is like this, then obviously the chances of having a depression would be quite high. That is a female sex, younger age, not having a spouse, poor social support, lower education, low socioeconomic status, poor glycemic control, presence of diabetes complication. Now if the person has diabetes complication, the chances of depression is also is higher. And presence of medical comorbidity, physical impairment, a previous history of depression. So these are the risk factors for developing a depression in person with diabetes. Now, if I may just add here, that is also like what we have seen is a family history of depression also. Though this study did not say that, but at the same time, we have seen a person in the diabetes, if they have family history of depression, then also the chances of having a depression in the person is quite high. Now, Now it is important to understand that why we are discussing about the combination of the two, like diabetes and depression, and how can depression affect diabetes. Now this is, now there are number of reasons for that. Depression can affect person patient capacity to deal with their diabetes, including self-management. That is what happens, that in diabetes they have to do self-management because they have to monitor the blood sugar, they have to go repeatedly to the doctor. So if a person has a depression, then obviously that is affected, you know, because the motivation is low, they do not have the zeal, enthusiasm for go for all this investigation, for all this monitoring and so on. So just imagine if a person has a depression, then how seriously it can affect, you know. Then there is the evidence that people who suffer from both diabetes and depression have poor metabolic and glycemic control. Like there is also, there are many research where when the person has both these conditions, then the blood sugar level is also high as compared to the person who do not have depression. And not only that, having a depression, but also the intensity of depression is also high. And this is also important for all of us to understand, most of the antidepressant, they can cause hypoglycemia. Because there are, you know, many studies are there, so we have to be aware, like in such people when we give antidepressant, then we have to be careful because one can have hypoglycemia. We all know that hypoglycemia is a very dangerous condition. In fact, it's much worse as compared to hyperglycemia, when the increased blood sugar. Low blood sugar is more dangerous because that can affect the heart, that can affect, you know, make you unconscious and so on. So low blood sugar is very, very dangerous thing, which can happen in the person who also takes a antidepressant. It is also reported that depressed people with diabetes are less likely to adhere to treatment. That is, you know, they do not follow the regime and they do not go to the doctor. There is a poor quality of life. But the important thing is, the bottom line is that if we treat depression, there is evidence that most of the things are taken care of. You know, the glycemic control can also be there. The symptoms of mood can also be enhanced. You know, the quality of life can also be improved. You know, so the point is that if we can identify depression in people with diabetes, if we can treat a depression, so just imagine that with just treating an depression, you can take care of the glucose level also. And there is enough evidence for that, that even the blood sugar can also be controlled by that. Now, epidemiology, we all know it's double the risk of depression. And what is basically self-report, we always try tend to higher, you know, rate of common mental disorders are there, you know. But when the interviews are done, like when the interview technique means, self-report means that you give a questionnaire to person and the person fills up that questionnaire. Like something like, we have few scales are available. Those who are into psychology, they will know Beck depression inventory is like a self-report. Whereas, you know, there are interview-based techniques when they are there, then only we pick up the major depression. We will miss out because the person may not reveal so many things when the person, another person is asking. So we can miss out on other common things. And there is increased risk of, you know, in depressive disorder, have a 65% increased risk of developing diabetes. And the prognosis of both diabetes and depression in terms of complication, treatment, resistance, and mortality is much worse. And there is enough evidence for that. Even so, what it means is, when the both conditions are there, the complications are much more, even the death can occur much faster and so on, you know. So that is why there is a serious, you know, link between depression and diabetes. And of course, impact of diabetes is also there in the depression. Like, and these are the just studies I can say, that people who had, you know, and this is a large scale studies where people who have both these conditions, then there were twofold increase in death in people who have both this condition as compared to people only have depression, and 2.5 fold increase when the people had both this condition as compared to none. So just imagine that the risk is much higher even for the death also. And this is just to highlight that depression and diabetes, there are much more complications also. And these are complications. One of the major complications of diabetes is cardiac disease, you know, heart disease. Like people who have diabetes, your doctor will always say you should have your heart checkup done regularly. And those who have depression, and there is enough evidence that the chances of having this heart disease is also much higher, much earlier, and so on. And there is enough evidence for that. Even in children, there is a chance of, in children who have, you know, diabetes, and also depression, then the chances of retinopathy, the eye changes are also much more. And there are many changes that occur when both conditions are there, there is a macro and microvascular problem, sexual problems, and diabetes, foot disease, and even dementia also. So what it means that the complication much more in people who have depression as compared to people who do not have depression in people with diabetes. And these are some of the behavioral factors, you know, because what happens, how the link is there, because in depression, what happens? People will, the physical inactivity is there, they will just lie down, they will not do any activity which, you know, the diabetes doctor would have said that you should do physical activity, at least 30 minutes walk should be there. So in a person with depression will not do all this, which will again lead to obesity and which will may lead to diabetes. So there is a link in that way. And depression is associated also with the poor diabetes self-care. And number of factors already we have discussed, and emotional problems again, which can happen in person with diabetes, can lead to depression. There are certain biological factors. Now, one of the important thing is that depression, one of the link on diabetes is insulin resistance, and this is a very important link which can happen in a depression. What happens that, you know, there is a stimulation HPA axis, you know, and which can lead to insulin resistance, which and thereby increase the risk for diabetes. And also genetic level, also there is a link between diabetes and depression. Now these are certain problems which can occur. I will just quickly go through. Basically what can happen is, even in the clinical practice, sometimes patients do not know that I have a depression. You know, they may go to the doctor and they may complain about that, you know, some of the symptoms of diabetes. At the same time, we know that some overlap symptoms are there, say for example weight loss, you know, lack of energy, so which can happen in depression also. So there is overlap. So one has to understand, even the doctors also, medical doctor, like, you know, in medicine, most of the doctors are not trained for assessment of depression also, you know. So what happens in that case, so diagnosis of depression is missed out, you know, in most cases, unless it is very severe, then only they are referred. So but in the mild cases or more, you know, or moderate cases, they are often missed out. And also we need to understand that in case when there is a, in the person with diabetes, if there is a depression, then there is amplification of symptoms. The pain symptom would be much more, which may, they may give increased, you know, pain-killing tablets or analgesics instead of looking for depression. So there are so many links are there which are often missed by the patient, family, and even by the doctors also. And these are all some, and sometimes what happens, the stress of diabetes, person what may do? He may take more alcohol, which is not good in diabetes, but a person may have a depression, may take smoking may also be more, you know, because they are undergoing stress. So sometimes to relieve a stress, there is a common misconception that, you know, to smoke more, to take alcohol more, and so on, which again the underlying problem may be just a emotional problem. So these are certain problems can occur. I will just skip this. And so it is important. And sometimes what can happen that depression can lead to pessimistic view of the future. So this which is often missed out. So one need to look into this, that if the treatment is available for depression, then not only the depression but also diabetes can be taken care of. And these are interesting. There are a few studies from India also which has been done in the diabetes, and which also talks about, you know, that there are common mental disorders which are there, anxiety and depression is occurring in these patients. And this is one study which we did in our department, and which also which was published in one of the journal, and also mentions that, you know, that some of these parameters, the depression anxiety is much higher, and there is inactivity in people when there is a comorbid diabetes and depression. And this is recently we have done the meta-analysis. Meta is a combination of all the studies which we have just done that, and perhaps we could lay our hands to 22 studies. And these are some of the, you know, the findings which you can see, that in hospital setting there is higher prevalence of depression up to 70%, just imagine, in India, among diabetes and higher burden of anxiety disorder and somatoform disorder. In urban population it was about 41%. And patient health questionnaire was commonly used, you know, assessment tool which was done. And peripheral vascular disease complications were reported higher among patients in diabetes with depression. So already which I have mentioned, so there is evidence from India also. And so there is a high burden of common mental disorder in diabetes population, and it's a great challenge. And perhaps what we have recommended, so there has to be integrated or collaborative care should be there when we are managing a person with diabetes. Okay, so now I come to the second part, that is a study what we are doing. That is the integrating depression and diabetes treatment, that is the acronym is independent, you know. Now, this has been by the Emory University in US, and these are the collaborator, that is National Institute of Mental Health, NIH, then University of Washington, Madras Diabetes Research Foundation, All India Institute of Medical Science, that is our institute. So in India there are 4 centers, and in US there are 2 centers. And you can see that so these are all the collaborators, like from University of Washington, like I can tell my colleagues from psychiatry that the one of the authority in diabetes care or collaborative care is Wayne Caton. In fact, he was a PI in that, and he's no more, he unfortunately expired last year. And so University of Washington, he was a PI. Then Emory University from India, we have 4 centers. In fact, one is in Bangalore also, DICON, which recently has been taken up. And so they are, and it's basically a group of endocrinologists, you know. Okay, so and what the background was, basically one can see that there is a link between major depression and also smoking, sedentary lifestyle, obesity, lack of adherence, and which can of course lead to diabetes and heart disease and poor symptom control and so on. So there is a bidirectional link is there. Based on this, this proposal was made. Then the important thing, can responsive care help, you know? And there are 2 models for this, and one is a team care model, which I talked about by the Wayne Caton of University of Washington. That is, it was tested in 14 primary care clinics, for 214 patients were taken up with poorly controlled diabetes and cardiovascular disease and also depression. So diabetes, poorly controlled, cardiovascular disease and depression. And intervention was done basically by the nurse. So there was no specialist involved in that, only nurse was the care coordinator, and she interact and supervision by the specialist. So what happened that in this particular study, the nurse was the main person. She took the history, she took all the details, and she consulted with the various specialists like psychiatrist, diabetes expert and so on, then gave the advice to the patient and the family. And what happened, better A, B, C, D. A means, A is basically better, A means HbA1c. HbA1c is the marker for the glycemic level, that is a blood sugar level. And it's basically tells about the blood sugar, average blood sugar of last 3 months. B is for blood pressure, so there was a control of sugar level, there was a control of blood pressure. C is for control. C is for cholesterol, so there was a control of cholesterol level, and D is for depression. So just when the nurse is coordinating and discussing with the supervisor, so there is a benefit in these 4 areas. That is, sugar level goes down, blood pressure goes down, then cholesterol level goes down, and depression also improves. So that is one of the important study by the team care, which was one of the PI for this study. Another study, my colleague from endocrinology is already involved in, CAR study, that is a cardiovascular risk reduction study, basically, and it's in 9 sites in India. In fact, 8 are in India, 1 in Pakistan, and one can see basically in this study also there is a care coordinator involved, but here there is a slight tweak is there. There is a DSS, decision support system. So there is an algorithm, there is a computer is there, based on that the treatment is given. You know, so in the previous one there is no computer or no support system, here there is a computer, and the analysis is right now ongoing. Now basically this particular study, independent, is combination of the two, you know, team care and the CAR study, that is translatable way of delivering care of comorbid chronic condition and depression. That is a chronic condition, that is diabetes here and depression, and combines the CAR study and the team care study, and that's what the independent study is. And of course, it's translatable, that is effective, it improves controls, not only the diabetes and cholesterol level, but also depressive symptoms, as good as specialist care. So, because we all know that specialists in our country is very less, you know, we all know that number of psychiatrists are very less. So one needs to develop a program or say some any effective model by which we can benefit to the patient without a patient seeing a specialist. And also, it can be adopted in routine practice, acceptable and cost-effective. It has to be cost-effective. So that was the way of that the premise by which this project was envisaged. So there are two basic aims were there. One was the qualitative study, that is, understand patient, family, provider perspective, culturally made, and you know, and basically look at the diabetes and depression, and you know, a lot of discussion was there. We had looked into the patient, provider. We did, you know, focus group discussion, and so on. And so this was the qualitative part, because we wanted to look at the cultural aspect also. Then the aim two was, which is the, this is a, what is the RCT design, that is a, looking at the effectiveness and cost effectiveness of intervention, that is achieving 50% reduction in the depression by SCL. My colleagues in psychiatry will know SCL is symptom checklist, 20 item. Then also reduction, 0.5% reduction in HbA1c, which is a marker for sugar level, and reduction of 5 millimeter mercury of blood pressure, and reduction of 10 milligram per deciliter of LDL, that is a marker for the cholesterol or fats in the body. So these were some of the outcome measure. And of course, looking at the quality of life measures and health expenditure and cost related, and this was the RCT design. And one can see that these are the design. Like, if you can see, diabetes patients were taken with either of high sugar level, that is HbA1c of more than 8, or blood pressure level of more than 140, or LDL level of more than 130, or PHQ of more than 8, of more than 10. Because if you see PHQ for depression, 10 and above is taken as mild depression, you know, 10. And we did not take a severe cases here, because severe cases we have excluded from this study because of risk of suicide and all. So usual care is where, you know, they were given the usual treatment, whereas in this one can see the care coordinator here, because basically care coordinator, what we understand, diabetes clinic, they are mainly nutrition experts. So they could do stimulate self-care, support self-care, and so on. And DS is a decision support system. Electronic health record was made, algorithm was made based on this, you know, the treatment was planned. And also case review meetings are being held. Like for this study, almost every week we all sit together, the cases are discussed, and we advise. We do not see the patient of the, we just advise, and the advice is given to the patient. Until now we can see that a lot of benefits are been happening to these patients. So ultimately it is to integrate the interventions to reduce the depressive symptoms in the routine diabetes clinic in India. That's the whole idea. And the condition of diabetes, we are giving patient education, behavioral activation, depression, we are doing supported self-care by care coordinators, and also cardiovascular risk factor also taken care by diabetes expert, decision support system, electronic health record system, because the treatment for high lipid level are also are given. So this is about the the study what we are doing. Just briefly about, you know, I will just quick, how much time, sir, I have? Okay, fine, I will wind up. Just briefly about, you know, this is the model of WHO, because if you can see that even the project was based on this collaborative care model. And these are some of the principles. Those who are working specifically when we are in this yoga institute, we need to look at, not at the, you know, at individual level. I think when we are working, in fact, we need to work and move away from what we do our usual practice. We need to interact. We need to, you know, collaborative care in comorbid condition are, treatment of the, it is most effective. And these are like multidisciplinary approach, presence of case manager, like here, already I gave the example, regular systematic case reviews, which can, or case discussions, which can help, close collaboration, and self-management system, and so on. So these are collaborative care model, which is effective and evidence proven all over the world for management of comorbid condition. And in fact, this is one, we just wanted to inform, like we work in a multiple specialty institute where we have different department. So we interact with our colleagues in medicine and other department. We interact with them because they want to know about depression and so on. So, you know, so that is why it's important for we also to interact with them, or they also want to interact with us. And there's a need for antidepressant treatment, of course, because as we all know, it's under-treated, under-diagnosed. So we need to, in people, person with diabetes, we need to identify and treat these people. And treatment is can take care of many complications, and can morbidity can also be reduced. And these are the need why we need to give a treatment, because of for the depression, that is for the drug compliance, for the social support, adherence for treatment, self-care management, and this is evidence-based. American Diabetes Association, just I think that's very important for us to understand, because not in India, but there, recommends that diabetics, particularly with poor disease control, should be screened for psychosocial and psychological disturbance such as depression. So they have already made the guideline. So even a person who is not improved in the diabetes status, so they should be screened for the depression. Effective independent intervention do exist for depression, diabetes, but of course when they occur together, so the efficacy goes down. So it is important to look at both these conditions, look at the identify depression and treat this condition. So while treating, in fact, these are all documents we prepared, you know, because we wanted to make the algorithm. So this all, how to help these, our physician and the care coordinator. So these are some of the information which may be are important for giving the treatment for a person with diabetes and depression. So like consider biological sequelae resulting for comorbid depression. Like biological sequelae could be like basically increase in the pain symptoms or increase in the, you know, glycemic control. So these are biological. Behavioral sequelae resulting for comorbid depression are behavioral sequelae, not going to the doctor, lack of motivation, lack of energy, not following the advice of a doctor, you know. So that's the behavioral sequelae. And of course, looking for helplessness, giving up, and all this can happen because, as already talked about, burnout and comorbid anxiety and panic attack can look like a hypoglycemia. So one has to be careful when we are dealing with such patients. Choice of antidepressant, I think we had a lot of discussion with Wayne Caton, because in US, in their clinic, they use bupropion. My psychiatric colleague will know, because what they feel that SSRI can lead to sexual side effect, but what we had discussed in India, we do not have that much of a problem with sexual side effects. So we could say in our study also, this SSRIs are number one drug. And there is a role of, you know, so non-pharmacological method, I will skip that. Now coming to the yoga, I think, and there is enough evidence in the diabetes. In fact, I'm looking at, you know, and there are in fact meta-analysis, systematic reviews are there. And there are, in fact, 85% published work has been, related work has been done in India. And hot yoga is one technique. I'm not expert in diabetes, but they said it's very effective, basically looking at the stress marker and so on. So there is evidence for that. And also one can see this, you know, systematic review is there, where 363 participants were there and they had reduction in diabetes status, but at the same time it was not statistically significant. So also that is also we need to understand, but there is the evidence that the diabetes there is reduction. But the important thing is we do have a treatment, yoga for depression, we do have a diabetes. So I do not see any reason that in these comorbid condition yoga can also be an effective way. I think in the future one can look at some of these prospective studies and so on. And this is one, basically we're talking about diabetes and depression. I just wrote, there is a one textbook which is there, or textbook on non-communicable disease. We wrote a chapter on mental illness integrating with, non-communicable disease. And we had written about diabetes also in this. And these are some of the experts I have taken from the, basically how important it is, which is already highlighted in this chapter also. To conclude, depression and diabetes are prevalent, often comorbid in population. There is a bidirectional relationship, which is for us to understand, very important. And there is a depression seriously affect diabetes and its complications. By now, I think we all know that. And there is a negative impact of diabetes in person with depression, that is even to the mortality, you know, and the rates are 2.5 times higher. In general, non-pharmacological treatment and along with SSRI are treatment of choice. And collaborative care model, again I'm highlighting this, is the treatment of choice. I think we need to look at that. And and this is just I took from one of the Diabetes UK report, which is available in the website, 2008 report. You can see that, you know, the so much line is there in diabetes psychological clinic, you know, and people are waiting, and there also the gap is very huge. In fact, we think in India it's huge, but in UK also the tune of 60% the gap is there. So what I think it is for the future, I think we need to understand that to look at depression or say common mental disorder in person with diabetes. With this, I think I will hand here. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving the opportunity to speak in this forum. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sagar. We have heard common mental disorders, we have heard one of the common mental disorders, depression, being widely prevalent in diabetes. This 21st conference is a confluence of mental health and also lifestyle disorders like diabetes, and it is very appropriate that we have had a session on depression and diabetes. Having heard the two important conditions, and also in the plenary session about severe mental disorders, now we are going to hear how yoga can be used in at least two of the important conditions, psychosis and depression. I now invite Dr. Shivarama Varamballi, who is an additional professor in psychiatry at NIMHANS, also an alumnus of NIMHANS. He has, to his credit, several publications, close to 70 publications in different peer-reviewed journals. He has won several awards. Important of them is the Jairam Award, which is given to a very important prestigious paper presented in the South Zone Indian Psychiatric Society. He has been recently credited with a very important project funded by the Wellcome DBT. For the first time, an international funding body in India has given a project on mental health, and it is related to yoga, more importantly. It's going to investigate the role of yoga in schizophrenia in a highly well-designed study, and as a young investigator, he has received this award. And lastly, to his credit, is a publication of use of yoga in psychosis, which has been recognized world over, and an international treatment guideline, NICE, National Institute of Clinical Excellence, while mentioning treatments for psychosis, mentions his work on use of yoga and recommends for the first time, very recently though, use of yoga in treating psychosis as an adjunct. So, to this credit goes to Dr. Shivarama Varamballi, and we have Dr. Varamballi here presenting use of yoga and how to build evidence in applications of yoga in mental disorders. Dr. Varamballi.
Thank you, sir, for that generous introduction. Of course, most of the work that I have done is with the guidance of Professor Gangadhar himself, so most of the credit should go to him, actually. What I am going to talk on is continuation of what Dr. Anand Pandurangi spoke in the morning. He gave a very good lecture on the severe mental disorders. So I am very happy to be presenting on a day that he has spoken. Half of my work is already done. And it's very nice to see a yoga institution like this conduct a conference like this and devote a section to mental health, which is otherwise not very well recognized in terms of yoga for especially severe mental disorders. I say this because when I started working in the yoga center, we were fairly surprised to see that the use of yoga for this kind of disorders was almost non-existent. In fact, the credit for doing the first possible work in yoga in psychosis would possibly go to S. Vyasa back in 2000, although it was not published. A project done here was the first to show the way that yoga could be taught even to people with fairly severe psychosis. So we have taken input from S. Vyasa and we have gone ahead with that. So I will speak briefly about why we should do that in the severe mental disorders and how the evidence is shaping up. Of course, I should acknowledge the people who have been there actually in this whole work, including Dr. Gangadhar, Dr. Jagdish and other members. So the impact of severe mental disorders, Dr. Pandurangi has covered in the morning. I need not go into much detail. But if you look at the dailies, the amount of burden on the person and the family, the impact of mental disorders goes even beyond other chronic conditions such as tuberculosis. and even diabetes. So you can imagine from what Dr. Sagar said, if you add depression and diabetes, the burden is almost be double. So this was a study in 2005. And why we should look at yoga as a therapy in schizophrenia? Yoga, of course, has been used for millennia in terms of improving one's physical health and has proven benefits in several areas, including both physical and even cognition or the functioning of the brain. Specifically to mention blood glucose and lipid levels, cognitive performance, markers of stress. Dr. Khalsa is here, who has worked on stress and yoga. He would be agree with this, that there is quite a bit of work on stress reduction with yoga and markers of the same in terms of neurophysiological and also sleep. And conversely, people with schizophrenia have problems in all these areas. They have problems with physical health, they have problems with depressive and anxiety symptoms, they have problems with cognition, and they also have problems with sleep. So, and also, of course, the recent medications for the treatment of schizophrenia tend to rather increase these problems, especially what is called as the metabolic syndrome. And we in India somehow seem to be more prone to develop these kind of complications with these medications. This so-called syndrome X is the largest in India as compared to many other countries. Also, again connecting with Dr. Anand Pandurangi's talk in the morning, your schizophrenia is now being seen as what is called as a connectopathy. It might be disconnection between thought and effect, it might be disconnection between different parts of the or the two halves of the brain, but there is a severe lack of connection in schizophrenia. So if you call it as a connectopathy, the very word yoga means to unite or to connect. So yoga should theoretically have a role in improving the symptoms of schizophrenia. So this was the first study. It was done as a thesis by one of our MD students in IMANS and was published in the Acta Psychiatrica in 2007. This was a trial comparing yoga and exercise in people with stable schizophrenia who are already on medication. One point to please note in that, in people with psychosis, yoga has been only tried as an adjunct, not as a sole therapy. They do need antipsychotics, but of course yoga might reduce the need for those antipsychotics, but it's not that they are not on medication. So this was a study comparing yoga and physical exercise in the management of schizophrenia. And what we found is that symptoms and functioning both improved in the group that got yoga more so than exercise. Exercise also has several benefits in this condition, but yoga was over and above that, and particularly so in two important areas. One is what we call as negative symptoms of schizophrenia, which Dr. Pandurangi explained, which includes loss of motivation, loss of ability to interact with people, and severe reduction in the social drive. So that was a point that significantly improved in these people who participated in the yoga group. And the second was what we call as socio-occupational functioning, which involves the essential functions that we carry out every day in terms of society. So those two things significantly improved. So what we concluded is that yoga is a useful add-on treatment, and the improvements are seen across symptoms and actual real-life functioning. No serious adverse effects, but this study lacked an important element, that is a placebo or a waitlist group. So we sought to remedy that in a second study, which was an Ayush funded project by Professor Gangadhar and our team at NIMHANS, where we did two, three things extra. One is we added a waitlist group with a fairly similar study design, and we also measured something that is a very important a factor in schizophrenia, that is social cognition, the ability to recognize emotions in other people, what is called as facial emotion recognition deficits. So if your friend or your wife or your boss is saying something, would you recognize whether they're angry with you, whether they're upset with you, whether they're happy with you? This ability is seriously lacking in most patients with schizophrenia, which of course you can imagine leads to difficulties in social functioning. So this trends is a tool to measure how well you are able to recognize emotions in the other person's face without them speaking. So this is a series of photographs and videos by trained actors displaying the Navarasas or the nine emotions and how well people are able to recognize that. This was designed by one of our students at NIMHANS. So this is the flowchart of the study. There are three groups: yoga group, physical exercise group, and a waitlist group, who went through total of 4 months, and the assessments were done before and after 4 months. What we actually saw is that, again, similar to the first study, the improvements were seen in symptoms, again predominantly so in the negative symptoms as well as in the socio-occupational functioning at the end of 4 months. And if you look at the odds ratio, the likelihood of improvement was, especially negative symptoms, was 5 times more in the yoga group compared to both the other groups. So this was what Dr. Gangadhar was mentioning, that these two studies, Dr. Ganeshan Duraiswamy's study and this study, was quoted by the NICE guidelines released in February 2014, and they have added yoga as a complementary treatment in schizophrenia for the first time. What I said about social cognition, we found that yoga significantly improved the ability to recognize emotions, and this we hypothesized that may be linked to the improvement in social functioning in these people. This was published again in the